Before I start my review, I want to say a huge thank you to a YouTuber called Dominating Spud. I'm going to put a link in the description below to this guy's page. He named me the number one most underrated YouTuber, in his video. I guess that's kind of the point of his page, is to point out new YouTubers. He does new episodes. I was checking out his page. I just thought it was the coolest shit ever. It totally made my day. And I just had to mention it. I definitely think you should check him out. And I'm definitely going to support his page. So anyway, thank you so much. Now let's get to the review. Moving on in the Critters series, we are going to be talking about Critters 2, the main course. I didn't show you this pack last time. This is the set I have. This is a good way to get all four. It used to be pretty cheap, but I just looked on Amazon. It's like $20. It has a little bit of different artwork than this. But this is a great set for, I think I got it for like $8 or something when it was out. But $20's not bad either. I think all four are fun. From my memory, I enjoyed all four. So let's get into it. I have a lot of shit to say about this movie. When I say shit, I don't mean bad. It's almost all good. But, as I say, I keep notes. And I've never written this much positive for a fucking movie. Now, does that mean it's like the best movie I've reviewed? No, it just had a lot of little things. So let's get into it. This movie takes place, if you haven't seen it, I'm going to be talking spoilers here. As I said, older movies like this, I'm always going to talk spoilers. So I'm sure you've seen this. This takes place 2 years after. Brad comes back to Grover's Bend to stay with his grandmother. And, no one is believing him anymore. Or no one believes him from before, so they all think that he's the crazy kid. What the fuck happened to Brad's family in this, I have no idea. It's not disclosed where they went, any of that. So I thought that was kind of lame that there's no explanation. So this one is directed by Mick Garris. And, Mick Garris is hit and miss, but I love Mick Garris. He's done so many cool films. Lin Chaney returns as long as Scott Grimes as Brad Brown. So we get him back. Harv has been replaced. The actor was replaced by Barry Corbin, who is, Maurice Minifield in the amazing Northern Exposure series. That's a fun show back in the day, 90s. Not horror, though, so we're not going to talk about that. The bounty hunters return as well. This time, Ugg is still the rock star throughout most of the movie, and Lee is, has yet to find his identity. It was actually this first time I kind of feel stupid, but this is the first time I caught that their name is Ugg Lee. So I thought that was cute. I found it funny that the incubation period on these critters' eggs seems to just be like 2 years. I mean, clearly it's because they get next to the heat, but I just found that kind of fucking funny. Now let's get into the good. I mean, there's a ton, so let's get into it immediately. First, I like that they took Charlie with them and made him a bounty hunter. It kind of made this redemption story from 1 to 2. He's this town drunk, he's a loser, this and that. Now he's a bounty hunter. Then he saves the day at the end. Then he becomes the sheriff, which is bullshit, by the way. You can't just throw him a star and be like, you're sheriff. I mean, it's not how it works anymore. This is not the 1800s. But whatever. I liked that there was redemption there from Charlie's character. little baby crites are super adorable. I like that there's, the first one, I think, like, there's almost no deaths. I mean, I think Billy Zane's character dies, and I can't really remember anyone else really dying in the movie, but this movie has, a few deaths, like 6, I think. And there's a decent amount of gore, like bones, like people's bodies have been eaten down to the bones a few different times. I thought that was cool. I like that this was set on Easter to kind of play off of the eggs. So they could paint him and they could bring him out. I mean, it wasn't necessary because it doesn't really play into it, but it was a cool idea. I don't think it was completely executed, but I like that they went in that direction, that they painted them and the kids were out. They could have had them looking for them and the eggs could have cracked open while the kids were out there, but maybe they just thought that would have been too scary for a PG-13 film. Getting into the whole PG-13 thing, though, I was surprised by not only the gore and the cussing, but the nudity. Holy shit! I mean, they show the Playgirl, like in the Playboy magazine a bunch, but they also show when the bounty hunter, which is another positive of mine, the bounty hunter becomes this Playboy model, which is always wonderful, but that they show her tits like in a close-up shot too. I was like, whoa, this is hardcore. Reminds me of, like Airplane being PG and having full tits in it, the shaking boobies and the jello. This is just a different time. I mean, you could get away with shit like this. So that was funny. I was just like, whoa, boobies and really nice ones. I just really loved that the bounty hunter, and it also went from like hot chick to geek. Then she was trying to turn into Freddy Krueger, and he or it, I guess. It doesn't really have a gender, I don't think. But yeah, then he tries to turn into Freddy Krueger and turns back to the chick. I thought it was funny. I really like the bunny scene, the dude who gets talked into being in the bunny suit, and then like that whole scene where he's like trying to zip his thing and then they jump into a suit, and then just that, when he jumps through the church window, I just really like that scene. I really like how it was done. It just flowed very well. I like that this had a lot of humor in it. I laughed a good amount throughout this movie. I liked that there was so many more critters. Now, I don't know where the fuck they all came from. There was only like 20 eggs. So I don't know if like they got some gremlin shit going on and getting them wet or eating, they expand more and they like pop off of each other by eating. I don't know how all of a sudden there's like literally like 1,000 of these things. But whatever. Give me more. I don't give a shit. I love the diner shootout, kind of the first big action sequence in this movie where the bounty hunters go in the diner and they start shooting them up, and they're all exploding, they're eating burgers, and and then one of them falls in the deep fryer and it's all like, it's skin hairless and it's all fucking nude. I thought that was really funny. I love that they block the road out of town and laugh about it when that dude tries to leave town. It just kind of reminded me of the scene in the first one where I was talking about how they just came back and blew up the house to be dicks. Like, this just furthered that, kind of attitude that they had. Like, we're trapping you in town and we're gonna make you laugh about it. Like, we're gonna laugh about it. And it's, could that guy have driven around and went somewhere else? Like, is there only roads out of town? He couldn't have, like, went a little off-road with it, but. Can't overthink things like this. I like that the bounty hunters did more in this one. I don't think I complained about that enough in the first one, and I had something that I wanted to say and I kind of forgot. Is that the bounty hunters in the first one kind of reminded me of the Australian dude in Jurassic Park. Like they build him up to be this big character, this raptor, expert and this master hunter, and then he gets killed by the first fucking raptor he sees. It's just he's so underused as this potential threat to everything. In the book, he kills a few raptors before he dies, and it was a shame that he didn't get to kill more. But with the bounty hunters in the first one, it was kind of just like they came and they killed like two critters. Like, really, they didn't do a whole bunch. Like, they didn't really even need to be in the movie outside of, just to make it cool and they looked fun and it was a great part of the movie. I'm not saying it wasn't, but they didn't do a whole lot in the film to help. And they're supposed to be the ones that are coming in. It was the family that really did everything. And in this one, the bounty hunters play s much, much bigger, substantial role. I mean, they kill the majority. I mean, they kill almost every critter in this film. If you count the Charlie ship kill at the end, which he's a bounty hunter at that time. So yeah, I just like that they were more. I like that this movie had a faster pace. And it kind of still had to do what the first one did. It had to kind of reset things up. And it had to kind of, you know, get us back to where the critters came from and the bounty hunters were coming back. And this wasn't a typical sequel where it just like played right into the next one and no establishing characters had to be done. And no, you know, this one actually had to kind of reestablish itself. Like, who are these new characters and why are the Krites back? And, you know, so, and I felt like it just flowed better. It went at a more of a brisk pace. And I like that. I like that they killed one of the bounty hunters. I like that they killed Lee. I mean, it sucks that the character had to die, but it just made, you know, the threat of the critter seem stronger, and it made the bounty hunters not seem so, you know, impervious to damage and death. And like in the first movie, it just kind of seemed like they were there and nothing could stop them. It was just basically like the Krites had no chance against them. And it almost just seemed like this lopsided battle. And then this one, I mean, they fucking gang up on Lee. And they completely destroy her. So, or him, or it, as I said. I forgot to add that when she does turn into the Playboy model, because it's the centerfold and there's the staple and the staple in the chest, I thought that was really goofy, but I liked it. I liked that this movie embraced its silliness. Like, it's okay. Like, you can be goofy and you are, and they didn't take it too over the top. It wasn't like slapsticky. It was just the right amount of goofy. This is written by the guy who did the Riddick trilogy. Which is interesting. I mean, I guess that's set in space and this is about space creatures, but I don't know. They're completely different tones. I just was like, oh, wow, this is the guy who did all those. So now let's move into my negatives. And most of my negatives are small, small, nitpicky stuff. So I really have very little bad to say about this movie. Number one, the killing of that dude's dog. Never cool. I don't like dead dogs in movies. Oh my God, Michael Myers kills like a dog every movie. And it's like my favorite shit. I have to watch it every time. I don't know why this annoys me. I'm going to bring Halloween up again. I guess I bring this a lot, especially Halloween 4. I seem to really talk about that a ton. There's a part in this movie where Brad is looking at a picture of him and Charlie. And it's clearly a still from the first movie. I mean, it's the scene where he's got the slingshot. And he's about to shoot the sister. And she's going to get mad. She's going to blame it on him. It's clearly that scene. And it's like, that picture is not possible. They were not there. And that same thing happened in Halloween 4. When Jamie Lloyd is looking through her shoebox of pictures. And she finds a picture of her mom. And she's looking at it. It's clearly the picture of Laurie sitting on the stoop with the pumpkin. And it's like, there wasn't anyone there taking pictures. That picture's not possible. It's clearly from that moment and that day. Unless during that scene, like, Annie drove them back and took a picture of them real quick. We all know that's bullshit. Small, as I said, these are super small. There's very little, but I just thought I'd mention them. One thing I did kind of have a little bit of a problem with, and it seemed like the movie actually agreed with me, is Brad and Megan's, like, attraction or love interest or whatever. Like, Brad is 15 and this chick is 21. Like, in the movie, I don't know what their age difference is, but it's considerable. Like, he's 15 and I think she's supposed to be 18. But I don't know. I didn't feel it at all. And they interrupted their kiss 3 times in a row. And then the kiss they did give them was so fucking lame. There was no passion to it. There was no sparks. There was no romance. There was no nothing. I mean, shit. People kiss their grandmothers more fucking passionately than that. So yeah, I don't know. That whole thing was silly to me. The scene where Charlie crashes into them. This is a bounty hunter ship. And, like, there wasn't guns on it. I mean, granted, maybe Charlie didn't know how to fire the weapons, or, you know, who knows? But just like crashing the ship into them, blowing it up instead of, I don't know. I was just like, there's no guns on this thing? Bullshit. And I already mentioned the other two I have written down here, so yeah, that's it. This was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed going back and rewatching this. I actually prefer this to the first one. Call me crazy. It was just more fun. I like goofy movies. Not always. I love plenty of serious films, but I just enjoy. This reminded me a lot of Gremlins 2. Like, if Critters 1 is Gremlins 1, this is the Gremlins 2 of, you know, this. It just kind of elevates everything, gives you more and more and more fun. I actually prefer the Gremlins 2 to, as well, as I said, call me crazy, but it's just escalated, and there's more fun, and there's more gags, and there's more effects. Oh, another thing I forgot to mention here. I really liked fuck, two great things. The critter ball is hilarious. Come on, that shit was great. Rolled over the guy and it was all skeletons. And then the critter effects, I didn't talk about this. The critter effects were great, man. Like when they were chewing and their mouth was like rippling as they chewed, like whoever did the special effects on this was great shit, man. My hat's off to Mick Garris and everyone. I know I read that Roger Ebert called, you know, put this in his list of worst movies he ever saw. Fuck that, man. I know Roger Ebert wasn't a fan of horror much at all, but come on, man. Roger, you should have had more fun, man. This movie's a blast, so I'm really looking forward to getting to part three with Leo.